I have with great pleasure the opportunity today to celebrate a fine, beautiful day in Newfoundland by talking with the Honorable J.R. Smallwood, who is in the throes at the present time of a brand new book that is now out on the market, and it's become quite a source of topic for all literary interests in Newfoundland. And I'd like to talk with the Honorable J.R. Smallwood at this present time about the book and welcome him to another fine day in Newfoundland.
Yes, the more the better.
Yes, indeed. We've had some fine weather lately. And I guess I do hope you're getting out of the office here now and again to get a chance to enjoy it.
Yes, I do. I always say at banquets and so on across Canada and when mainlanders come to Newfoundland and I talk about the weather, I always say that we have the best climate in all Canada. And they look a bit surprised.
I was looking a little surprised.
They
do,
yeah, they look a little surprised. I say, of course, sometimes our weather is not all that we'd like it to be, but we have a wonderful climate.
Yes, I must say. It's good for the...
And often we have beautiful weather, too.
Yeah, we certainly have today, and I must say the climate seems to have done you the world of good. You're looking fine and fit and trim, if I might take a moment to say so.
And feel even more so.
Yes, you certainly are. Well, one of the first questions that I would like to present to Mr. Smallwood for a quick answer right away is, how are the sales going?
Going marvelously well. I've never seen a book go as well, so quickly, so immediately after it was published. I'm very happy. It's now for sale in Newfoundland in something over 300 different bookstores and department stores and shops and drugstores and hotels and motels and...
And at the summer games.
Yes, yes, and service stations, over 300. I don't think that in all Newfoundland's history there's ever been a book. Oh yes, magazines and newspapers, but not a book, a hardcover book, selling in as many as 300 different retail outlets. It's now almost anywhere you are in Newfoundland or Labrador, you can get this book.
And where would you say would come the greatest interest in a book to get it so many sales so quickly? How would you say people would have taken up an interest in this particular book?
Well, the book, of course, is very handsome. I got prices on the printing of it in Japan and Hong Kong and Italy and Spain and Holland and Germany and Czechoslovakia and Canada and the United States and England. I got the best price in England, and of course the cost of printing a book in color is fantastic.
Yes.
And I had to get it printed in the best place I could get it, the best price I could get, which is in England. And the book is therefore extremely handsome. You know, there are over 1,100 color pictures of Newfoundland. 1,100. Do you know that there's never been a book published in Canada before this one that had as many as 200 color pictures in it? Never a Canadian book. And this one has more than five times as many as any Canadian book of color has ever had. So I suppose, because we're Newfoundlanders and because we're so proud of Newfoundland and because this book really does put our best foot forward and shows Newfoundland to the very best advantage, I suppose people are sort of proud to have it. I suppose that's why.
I would say very much so. It's a beautiful book. You have how many people contributing?
Well, there were photographers, about 65. Different photographers who took the pictures that are in the book. But the 1,130 for color photographs in the book, I chose from among around 60,000, almost 60,000 color slides. It's a slide I need, not a print, a slide,
yeah, yeah,
or a transparency.
Yes.
And I picked from over nearly 60,000, and I boiled it down to just over 1,100, and I engaged two helicopters and I engaged three planes and sent photographers up in them, because a lot of the pictures are taken from the air. There's so many places in Newfoundland that you cannot photograph except from the air, and so I plunged. You know, I spent around $10,000 to get these photographs taken, to pay photographers and the charter of planes and so on. And I must say I had some planes donated to me to go up and take some aerial photography. And there were about 65 different photographers, and I employed myself five. I had one man full time, David Miles, a really superb Newfoundland photographer. I had him for 2 months, and I had other photographers, Myrna Kiley.
Oh.
Eddie Ringman took a lot of pictures. Lorne Ross Totsky, formerly of Gander, now in St. John's, who is a superb...
He's won awards.
He really is a superb photographer.
Beautiful work.
I had him. And so altogether, this book is the result of the skill and the experience and the artistic knowledge and skill of a lot of photographers. So altogether, there were about 65 photographers, of whom I had a number. I had five employed.
Yourself.
And I took a few myself, by the way.
Did you?
Yeah.
Did you?
I took a few.
Well, now we'll have to mention maybe later on, if you can think of exactly whereabouts in the book they are. I'd like to compare your work.
It's better. I must confess to you that my... As a photographer, I do not compare with Eddie Ringman or Myrna Kiley or Tommy Smith or Phil Smith or Lorne Ross Totsky or any of the great Newfoundland or Rocky Schulstad out in Cornerbrook. I don't compare with them. So I would rather let my photographs be anonymous.
Okay, we'll try to pick
They're not bad.
No.
But they're not great.
You have part of the book taken up with scenic shots of the island and, of course, Labrador. And you also have a fair amount of the book taken up with people.
Yeah, about half and half. The face of Newfoundland. If you want to show the face of Newfoundland, you don't do it. You can't do it by just showing scenery. Lakes and ponds and rivers and waterfalls and hills and mountains and coves and islands and coastline and buildings and so on and so on. They're part of the picture of Newfoundland, but if you leave people out, then it's not truly the face of Newfoundland. So the book is about half and half, half people and half places and things.
Well, of course, your face is one of the main faces of Newfoundland and has been for quite a few number of years. I would have presumed that your picture is amongst there.
Well, it crept in there. It crept in. But I haven't leaned on politicians. I have, the lieutenant governor, and I have the queen and the lieutenant governor. But then I also have the lieutenant governor of Nova Scotia, because he's a Newfoundlander from Spaniards Bay, Dr. Goss.
We have an amazing amount of distinguished people over the world who are Newfoundlanders, and you've documented them quite nicely.
Some pages of them, the head of the Armed Forces of Canada, General Carr. Oh, I have a lot of people. I have the Premier in, I have the Speaker of the House of Assembly, and then I have the Privy Councillors, the Newfoundland Privy Councillors, Mr. Jameson, Mr. Brown, Mr. Granger, and myself. There are only four of us living today in the world.
Newfoundlander Privy Councillor.
Who are Privy Councillors. So we have them in.
Now, a Privy Councillor is an advisor to the Queen?
That's right. Privy means private. Private Council, Privy Council, and whose members, the councillors, the Privy Councillors, are the advisors to the Queen, yes. The Queen appointed me, and her signature is on my appointment. This gives you and it gives to any member of the Cabinet or the Privy Council, I mean the Cabinet of Canada, the federal.
The federal Cabinet.
It gives them the title for life of honourable. If you're not a member of the Privy Council, then you're honourable, you have the title, the rank, honourable, only while you're in office. Our Premier, for example, Mr. Moores, if he serves another 2, 3, 5, 10, 20 years, it doesn't matter how long he may serve.
23?
Well, as Premier, whatever he serves, unless he becomes a member of the Privy Council. The day he resigns as Premier, he won't have the title, the rank, Honourable Frank D. Moores. Mm. He will have it while he is Premier. But once you become a member of the Privy Council, you have that title for life. That's why William J. Brown is the Honourable W. J. Brown, and and Don Jameson, as long as he lives, will be the Honourable Donald Jameson. I'll be the Honourable Joey, yes. And Charlie Granger will be the Honourable Charles R. Granger.
Do you ever find an occasion to come upon an occasion that you need to advise the Queen to buy your book?
No, well, I wouldn't mind advising the Queen to buy the book. By the way, I have not sent her a copy.
Haven't you?
And I'm torn between two minds. I'm very proud of the book, as I think any Newfoundlander would be. And perhaps I ought to, but I don't want her to feel that I'm sort of nosy and pushing it, you know.
Would you
under her attention.
Would you allow me to send her one? Or?
I'd be delighted if someone sent the Queen a copy of my book, because I don't think that anybody on this earth today, anybody, could look through this book and fail to understand that Newfoundland and Labrador are a very wonderful and beautiful part of the world. You know, you cannot put 1,100 odd pictures in color, beautiful color, of Newfoundland and Newfoundlanders without creating a beautiful impression, which is what I try to do. It's a terrible gamble. You know, nobody in Canada from coast to coast has ever before put out a book of 256 pages, large pages, all color, all, not even one black and white, all color. No one has ever done it. And when I went to the bank here in St. John's to ask them to finance the book, to put up the money for it, you know, $250,000, boy.
Quarter of a million, eh?
Yeah. Any bank manager would think and think and think, and no doubt he had to consult the head office in Montreal before he got the okay.
For one book?
One book. 15,000 copies of that one book and 1,100 color photographs. It's a lot of money. It's a big gamble. And I may end up at the bank. The bank will end up. If I don't sell them all, the bank will end up, looking very black at me.
I guess.
And be no use my going back to them and ask them finance another book.
You've had various successes in other literary works, and maybe we'd like to talk about them for a little bit. This is not, by any means, your first endeavor in the literary field.
No, this is book number 16.
16.
And the books that I have published have had a sale of about 100,000 copies. About 100,000 people have bought these books and spent about $1.25 million out of their pockets to buy these books. Which, I'll tell you a secret.
Yeah, a secret.
The secret is this. Don't let it get
out.
Not a word.
Not a word.
Not a word.
Not a word.
Don't. The secret is this. That 50 years from now, I expect that there'll be people, young people in the university, in schools, colleges, Newfoundlanders, who'll say, this fellow Smallwood, who published all those books, beautiful books.
Beautiful.
The Book of Newfoundland, six volumes, and other books, now The Face of Newfoundland, this and other books that I'm going to be publishing in the next 8 or 10 years. This fellow Smallwood, who published those books, his name was Joseph R. Smallwood. Now, there was another fellow named Joseph R. Smallwood, Joey, who was a politician. Could it be that they were the same man, the same Joey Smallwood? And some people say, nonsense, you're talking nonsense. Of course not. This man, this publisher, this writer, this editor of books was one fellow, and Joey Smallwood, the other fellow, was a politician. I don't know if they were related. I don't know if they knew each other even. But one was a politician, and the other was a writer, was an editor, was an author. and was a publisher, somebody of real
That's about five or six different fellas. You've really thrown everybody off the track now. You're quite busy, aren't you?
Yeah.
You're amazingly busy.
And I love every moment of it.
What was your first book?
My first book was written in London. I was living in London, in England. And I got this idea to write this book, and I started to write it, and I wrote all day at the typewriter, and all night, and the next day, and the next night, 3 days and nights, I never stopped. I would get up from the typewriter and go out of the boarding house where I had a rooming house. I'd go out on the corner where there was a place where you could get a bite to eat, and I'd hurry back again. And I spent three times 24 hours writing that book. It was the life of Sir William Coker. Ah. Coker of Newfoundland. Small book, published in London. That was my first book. I'm looking forward eagerly to Professor Ian MacDonald's book up at the university. He's writing a definitive, a great, thundering, great biography of Sir William Coker. And in my opinion, it should be one of the great books of the 50s, 60s, and 70s in Canada, the life of Sir William Coker. My book was a slender volume, my first book. It had to be fairly slender to be able to write it in 3 days and three nights.
I would imagine, yes.
But I was very proud of it. It sold very well. There are not too many copies around now. That was my first book. And my present book, The Face of Newfoundland, is my 16th. And the one, sometimes people ask me, what is the one book of the 16 that you're proudest about? I have to say, perhaps, the Book of Newfoundland, Volume 1 and Volume 2 in 1937, Volume 3 and Volume 4 in 1967, Volume 5 and Volume 6 in 1975. Those six volumes with 3,500 pages and 5 million words. I'm thinking of printing a new printing of 1, 2, 3, and 4. I'm thinking of it. If I thought they'd sell, I can't afford to go to the expense of printing books if they don't sell, because it only takes one book to go in the hole badly, and then I've had it.
Well, this is it. The business of publishing literary works is fairly hazardous, I would imagine. Not necessarily for yourself, but maybe for a lot of other people.
Yeah, for the people who back you, the bank.
The bank.
But look, let me tell you something, and this does a Newfoundlander's heart good. In the last few years in Newfoundland, almost any kind of a book about Newfoundland, prose or poetry, contemporary or historical, so long as it's about Newfoundland or some part of Newfoundland's life, anybody who can get such a book as that published is bound to have readers, because people, it's amazing, the people that will buy Newfoundland books. Now, I have to say that the same thing applies in other provinces. All across Canada, in every province, there's a great surge of interest in the different provinces and in Canada as a whole. And I remember when a book coming out about Newfoundland, about once every 10 or 15 years, was a very exciting event. But today they come out 6 or 8 or 10 new titles every year, and it's encouraging to see our people building up their libraries of Newfoundland books. This is good. This is promising. This is encouraging, and I'm delighted to see it. And of course, as a publisher,
yes, of course,
of Newfoundland books, I'm all the more interested in it. But even if I didn't publish one or write one or edit one, I'm delighted to see so many people producing books about some aspect of Newfoundland and so many people buying those books.
Exactly.
This is good.
You have a remarkable library here in itself. As a matter of fact, your whole setting here for your work is remarkable, and I hope that our...
In this office here?
Oh, remarkable.
I suppose this office is unique. It has more pictures on the walls than any office in Newfoundland.
I would imagine.
And it's a veritable museum of pictures and cartoons and paintings. There are dozens upon dozens upon dozens and dozens of them. The walls are all crowded and full. And I am perhaps the only person in Newfoundland who has as his private secretary his granddaughter. And then, in addition to that, that granddaughter at the moment, at the present moment, is a married lady with three little girls. And sometimes these three little girls come here in the office, and on such days as that, there's myself and there's my granddaughter Josephine, who's called after me.
Of course.
And her three little children, my great grandchildren. Now, how many offices are there run by a man whose secretary is his granddaughter and who has her children, his great grandchildren, in the office? And then the walls are plastered with so many, many,
and not
many
only
pictures.
That, we had an opportunity to sit down and have a bite with you in your kitchen here. I mean, you have all the amenities.
Yeah, well, of course,
all the amenities.
I'm an hour away, you see, from my home on Roach's Line.
Sure.
It takes me an hour to get here and an hour to get back. That's 2 hours a day. Mm. And so instead of going out to eat, I have a kitchen here. And my granddaughter will get a bite for me. And if I invite a guest in to have a meal with me, and I invite close friends to come in sometimes.
No.
I had one man who's not a close friend, but he's the premier of the province, Mr. Moores.
Ah.
I had him in here for dinner one night.
Did you?
Yes, and he evidently enjoyed it because he came in at 6 o'clock and he left at 1:30 the next morning.
Did you? Yeah.
And we talked
that.
About
yes.
everything under the sun, you know. I've had a good many people in here visiting me. And
well, while we were here, we had somebody come in to buy your book.
Oh, yes. Well, this
bring it to
is happening
the other
all the time.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people are buying 3, 4, and 5 copies. And quite a few are buying a dozen copies. The largest number of copies in Newfoundland was 30. One man bought 30 copies, and he asked me to autograph all of them.
Should we mention the price?
Well, everybody knows that. It's $22.50.
Right.
And then there's the government of our province is under a heavy expense.
Of course.
And they have to spend a lot of money,
yeah.
and they have to put taxes on.
Is that why Mr. Moores would not be such a close friend? Because he's taxing your book.
Well, he's taxing all books. I'm afraid the tax was on before he came in.
Yes, we used to call it a little something for Joey.
Yeah, 3 cents for Joey. But
three,
then
yes,
the tax now is 10 cents, and it was 3 for Joey and 10 for Frankie.
Yeah,
but before I went out, it was more than 3 cents. It began at 3 cents and kept increasing on and on and on until today. It's 10%. But I said the largest number that anybody has bought so far is 30 copies. But there was a man in Toronto who sent an order, and $500 he sent. He sent $22.50 a copy. There's no tax in Ontario.
Hmm.
And so it came to 40 copies he ordered. He says he's going to send it to all his associates and friends. Well, it'll do Newfoundland a lot of good, all the copies that are circulated and distributed and read across Canada and down in the U.S.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's a marvelous panorama of Newfoundland scenes, and certainly Newfoundland faces in the face of Newfoundland. It's a pleasure to be able to look in the book, and I do hope that everybody else will have that opportunity as well. Thank you.